Good morning, everybody. Welcome to New Song. It's great to have you here with us this morning. Please feel free to stand as we worship.
Your way, it will be my joy to say.
to you, I can do anything. I can do all things, 'cause it's you who gives me strength. Nothing is impossible through you. Blind eyes are open and strongholds are broken. I am living by faith. Nothing is impossible. Trust in you, God. God, there's no one like you. God, we thank you for your grace and your mercy that you give to us each and every day, Lord. We don't want to take that for granted, Lord. We want to serve you. We want to love you. We want to be faithful to you, Jesus. We just love you.
Sing a new song. song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat.
Let's sing that again.
And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. And sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. And holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You
you.
Father, we adore you. We say, holy is your name. You're a holy God. You're a worthy God. We just lay our lives before you. We just love you, Jesus. Your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. If we could have our ushers come forward, I'm going to bless our offering. Lord, we're so grateful for this day. We're so grateful for the opportunity that we have to come worship together as a family, Lord, in freedom. Lord, thank you for this great country. We offer a blessing, Lord, on this tithe and offering today, Lord. Take these gifts and multiply them. Use them to continue your work, Lord. Thank you for this church, Lord. We ask that you come and bless today's service, Lord. Bless each person here. Pray that each of us would receive something special today. We praise you, Jesus. Amen. It's trunk or treat time. Yeah. It's Superman. Trunk or treat. This is going to be such an awesome time. We've worked so hard on this. It's going to be fabulous. And it's not going to be snowing Wednesday. It says 58 and sunny. Yes. Although I'm not wearing that little because I will be frozen still. All right, no classes are going to be held on Wednesday night because of trunk or treat. So if you come to a Wednesday night class, you don't need to prepare for that. You need to sign up to help us for trunk or treat. We have so much stuff going on. We still need about 15 people that will sign up to work carnival booths. They'll be inside, so it'll be nice and warm. But we really need some volunteers for that. So if you think you could stand there, if you buddy with somebody else, you could do hour and a half shifts. Otherwise, it's 3 hours. We'd really appreciate it if you guys could either find someone to do it with or sign up for your family and maybe trade off with the kids so that we could have people man all of the games. We also have set up today. We're going to take all the chairs out and try and get our carnival game set up. We're going to have pizza over in the gathering place right after church, and then we'll set up. On Wednesday, we're actually going to have a prayer meeting at 4:30 for everybody who's volunteering and working. We'll be meeting out in the parking lot. We have two prayer walks. One is tomorrow at 5:30. And one is the day of at noon. So if anybody would like to come to those. Yesterday, we went and shopped and spent $5,700 on more candy. So we don't need any more bags of candy, but if you'd like to donate towards that $5,700, we would love to have some of it back. And you can do that right out here in the gathering place. There's a booth set up out there if you feel called to do that. We also have plenty of room for more trunks in our parking lot, but we need to get you on the sign-up sheet because we're actually laying out how the parking lot's going to look and would like to know where your trunks are going to be so that you're not all sitting on top of each other. So if you could sign up for that, we would love to have a few more trunks. You don't necessarily have to decorate your trunk, but there's going to be two $50 prizes given for the best trunks, one for people's choice, they'll be voting as they walk around, and one for judge's choice, which will be the trunk or treat committee. So if anybody wants to bribe me, then I'm available. Let's see. Oh, the judging's going to be at 4 o'clock, so you have between 12 and 4 to set up your trunks. We'll have a decision by 12:15 for judge's choice, and then we're going to pray and go into our event. So please be praying for the next 3 days. We really, really want this to be a great outreach to our community. Pray for the children that are coming and the families, that they'll be blessed and that they'll want to make New Song their home, that they'll feel welcome here. All right?
Thanks. So that was Alicia, and you guys should definitely help out with Trunk or Treat. And as you can see, I am Superman, because I'm super pumped about Trunk or Treat. So I'm involved in Trunk or Treat. I'm doing a trunk. It's going to be awesome. I'm not sure if we're going to win, but I kind of hope we do. But there's a lot of competition, so you guys should come and compete against everyone else and win the $50 gift card. And then also, of course, the carnival games in here and stuff. So sign up at the access booth if you're interested in helping. Please help. And then, okay, so this Saturday is Pursuit. And it's November 3rd, which is a Saturday. And it's at 7 o'clock. And we're going to be praying for the upcoming elections and for our nation. So you guys should definitely come to that. Again, November 3rd, 7 o'clock here in the sanctuary. And then we are also partnering with area churches for 40 days of prayer for the USA. And you can get a schedule at the access booth, which is out those doors. And it'll tell you what churches is when the prayer is at, where the prayer is at which churches during which weeks. So pick up one of those. And then if you're interested in going to Israel next year, please come to the meeting November 18th after church. And then the Mouse Tale. So that's the name of this year's The Little Kids Christmas Show. And their performance is December 19th at 6 p.m. in the sanctuary. And if you have little kids, they have their practice every Sunday at 4 p.m. So make sure they get there. And then there's still tickets available for the Bobcat game outreach, the hockey game. So if you're interested in getting some tickets and inviting people and telling them about New Song and stuff, sign up at the access booth. And then, of course, stay connected with us at newsongbismarck.com. And I just like to reiterate again, trunk or treat, really awesome. Sign up, help out, donate money for the candy. Oh, I think Alicia has another.
Don't get scared, I'm not going to preach. I just was informed that the sheets last week from Trunk or Treat were missing from the access booth. So if you signed up for anything to do a Trunk or Treat last week, would you sign up again this week? We really will only ask you once.
Woohoo! So if you didn't sign up last week, now's your chance to sign up. Okay, so everyone go sign up. And then to transition us on, there's a video, and I don't know if you guys know this, but the youth group went on a retreat a week ago. It was called Face to Face Retreat, and we went to the Medora, and we stayed at the Badlands Ministry. So I want to thank you all for your prayers, if you prayed for the students. And I don't know if you guys know this, but God is pretty powerful. And he likes to speak to us whether we know it or not, and that's what the retreat was about. And oh boy, was there some awesome testimonies from students, and I had the privilege of going on that trip as well and helping out, and God spoke to me. Whew, crazy stuff. And there's a video that's going to play, and if you see, like the kids in the video, if you see them here and you want to ask them about retreat or whatever, I'm sure they'd be more than happy to tell you how awesome it was. So thank you all.
Give it up. That was pretty awesome. As face-to-face retreat, which is interesting because of what we're going to talk about this morning. If you have a bulletin, you can grab the there's an insert in there with outline in it. We're glad you're here with us this morning to celebrate the goodness of God together. And we're going to continue our series on transformation. If you were here last week, you may remember I had a big brace on my leg. Well, something happened this week that is kind of trippy. And thank you, first of all, for praying, because prayer works. I went to, at both services last week, I went forward for prayer at both services. So if you have any prayer requests, I strongly encourage you to go to these prayer teams because of what happened in my life this last week. As we talk about transformation, we've talked about how sometimes transformation is easy, sometimes transformation is hard, and there's this cycle that we all go through, and that's God's plan, this thing called transformation. And so this last week with my knee, I'm going to show you some pictures. The first picture is what my knee looked like last from the MRI. This isn't the actual MRI, but this is basically what it looked like. The MCL was, wouldn't that be cool if the MRI looked like that? Anyway, the MCL was snapped, and the PCL was snapped, and it was bad, and I was supposed to have them both reconstructed. So then that was on Friday, not just a couple days ago, but the Friday before. So I stood up here in front of you guys last week and told you about that. And on Tuesday night, I was sleeping, and I was awakened by this extreme pain in my knee, that like this shot of electricity, just like a knife, just stabbed me in the knee. And I woke up, and it was really painful. And the first thing that came to my mind was there was a healing that just happened. And I, of course, you're sleeping and you're not sure what's going on and you're in pain and you're thinking, this is what I was thinking anyway, is if I had a healing, why does it have to be painful? That doesn't make any sense. So I went back to sleep. So a little while later, I woke up again to the same experience. This extreme shooting pain just woke me up and happened two times. So I woke up Wednesday, went about my business, was waiting for a phone call to figure out when we were scheduled to do the surgery, and because I have to go to Fargo for it. And so I was waiting for a phone call, never came. About 5:15, I get a phone call from the doctor, and he said, Kurt, the more we look at this, we don't think you need to have surgery. And I'm like, how can that be? How can that, from Friday, yeah, you got to have both PCL and MCL, absolute, no, yep. No. And then Wednesday, you don't have to have surgery. Looking at the same MRI. How does that happen? Doesn't make sense to me. I want to see the MRI. I wish I had a before and after MRI. But I don't have to have surgery. And it's been incredible. Every day, my knee just gets better. I feel so good. I'm not quite ready to play hockey yet. But anyway, so thank you for praying. And again, I can't stress enough, if you need prayer, these teams that are up here praying for people, do it. It is worth it. And so again, thank you for praying. But I went through my own transformation this week. You know, the week before it was great surgery, going to be bad, and now no surgery. And so I'm really excited about that. And so again, thank you for praying. As we recap in this series that we continue called Transformation, the first slide there is the definition of the word transformation: an act, process, or instance of transforming or being transformed. A genetic modification of a bacterium by an incorporation of a free DNA from another ruptured bacterial cell. That's ruptured bacterial cell, that's us. And incorporation of a free DNA is Jesus. That's not really what it says, but that's just what I think. And then 2B says genetic modification of a cell by the uptake and incorporation of an exogenous DNA, which again, the reason I love that is it's from the inside out. God wants to modify, change us, make us more like himself, and so that we can be all that he's created us to be. The Greek word there is where we get our Greek word, or where we get our English word metamorphosis, metamorpho, to change into another form, to transform, to transfigure. And again, sometimes that's a nice process, and sometimes that is a very difficult one. We also went over creation presence versus manifestation presence, and that's what I think happened to me in my bed that night, is I had a manifestation presence of God in my knee, which, depending on who you are, you may believe that or not, but I do. Anyway, so faith versus fear, full life through the Spirit, we ask and God will give. God wants to refill us as we pour out. Then when we had the traveling team, we had Free International. We talked about schemes of the devil, schemes of God. Before I forget, Free International, for those of you that were here and were wondering what is happening since we had them here talking about the human trafficking and slavery, modern day slavery, we have a team that's getting launched. And there is stuff happening in January. We're looking at doing our next event, so you can stay tuned for that. Then we learn and get hope from the Old Testament stories, which we're going to talk about one today again. And we talked about Joseph last week, or Joshua, I'm sorry, in regards to ambush, wilderness, and response to God. Then we talked about inner strength, fasting, and Rahab shared their ministry, and they got a bunch of more people signed up for the ministry, so thanks for responding to that. So as we look at transformation this week, we're not going to look at so much the spiritual, external, like the demonic or angels or whatever. We're not going to look at that so much, even though there's some of that in this story. We're going to look at internally with us. So for instance, how many have ever heard this saying, I'm my own worst enemy? Anybody ever heard that? Anybody ever said that? I'm my own worst enemy. Okay, well, you are in good company this morning as we talk about Jacob and what he went through. And if you've heard the story of Jacob, especially the story we're going to talk about this morning, Jacob and wrestling with God or with an angel of God, if you've heard that story, don't check out, because I think you're going to see something different here this morning as we look at this story. Jacob, which his name means to undermine, or to usurp people. If you guys remember the story of Jacob, Jacob tricked his dad to get a birthright. He tricked his brother. He tricked lots of people. He also got stuck in a mess with Laban. If you remember Laban, his father-in-law, he wanted to marry Rebekah, and it was a process there. Jacob's dad is Isaac, one of the great men of faith of the Old Testament, and Jacob's grandpa is Abraham. So this is a guy who's in an incredible lineage of faith that we would think that as we find this story, as we unpack this story here, you would think that when we are coming to this guy named Jacob, that as we unpack the story about him wrestling with the angel, you would think that this guy is a man of God now. He is. How many have ever thought that Jacob, does anybody know how old Jacob was at the time he wrestled God? If you were here at the first service, don't say it. Most of the time, at least I thought, when I first heard the story about Jacob wrestling with the angel, I thought Jacob was probably like a young buck. You know, 20 years old, buff, ready to roll. Macho man. Not true. Jacob was around 97 years old. So when we think about Jacob in this story, he's not a young buck, but he has issues. Even though he has seen all these incredible things happen, remember the story of Jacob and the ladder, where he had the vision with the angels going back and forth from heaven? Another incredible story. This story that we're going to look at with him wrestling with the angel, all that stuff has already happened. So he should be Mr. Maturity, right? Mr. Mega Man of God. And yet, at 97 years old, this is the first time recorded in the text, in the Bible, that Jacob ever once said a prayer. Mr. Mega Man of God. He had been living on the shirt tails of grandpa and dad. So as we unpack this, this I hope relates to us in some way. This is in Genesis chapter 32, the first blank on your outline, which you can never say too much. Number one is reach out to God, he's reaching out to you. Reach out to God, he's reaching out to you. Jacob's whole life, God had been reaching out to him, speaking to him through his dad, speaking to him through his father, speaking to him through circumstance, literally having angels come and talk to him. But Jacob never felt the need to cry out to God for anything because he had it pretty good. I mean, he had troubles in his life, but he always had it pretty good. And he's in a lineage, a family lineage that is pretty stinking awesome. So what does he got to worry about, right? Well, as we unpack the story, Esau, the brother that he stole the birthright from, is coming down on him. He's coming down the road headed towards Jacob and his family. And Jacob is shaken in his boots. He is scared to death. This is something not new. This is something that is new for Jacob. He's like, this depth of fear has gripped him and has caused his whole world to be shaken. And let's look here. I just think this is so funny as we read this story, because he's crying out to God possibly for the first time, at least that we know of in Scripture, he's super afraid, and let's read what he says as he pleads to God. He says, then Jacob said, this is in verse 9, chapter 32, it says, and then Jacob said, O God of my father Abraham, and God of my father Isaac, the Lord who said to me, return to your country and to your family, and I will deal with well with you. I am not worthy of the least of all the mercies and of all the truth which you have shown your servant. For I crossed over this Jordan with my staff, the river Jordan, and now I have become two. His family had split. Deliver me, I pray, from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau, for I fear him, lest he come and attack me and the mother with the children. For you said, I will surely treat you well and make your descendants as the sand of the sea, which cannot be numbered for multitude. So what is happening here in this story? We got Abraham scared to death, and what does he start to do? He starts to name drop. This is a huge deal, you guys. Jacob is not sure if God is a good God. He knows it, generally speaking, but he doesn't know it towards himself. This story shows us the perception Jacob had towards God and helps us make sure that just like Jacob's perception is going to be corrected, that we get ours corrected if it's wrong. So let's take a look here. What does he do? He starts to name drop. Hey, God, I don't know if you like me, basically, he says. But remember, Abraham, my grandpa, and Isaac, my dad, they're pretty cool dudes, right? You like them. So can you kind of like me too? He's reminding God about Isaac and Abraham and all the incredible stories that he learned growing up as a child. Parents, grandparents, tell the stories of what God has done in your life. Don't ever stop. It's crucially important to your life of your child as they get older. This Bible says, train up your child as when they're young, and when they're old, they will not depart from it. This is Jacob's happening right here. Jacob is reminding God and name-dropping Isaac and Abraham, and he's playing something out in his life that is going to be a crossroads for him as this story unfolds. And then he cries out and he says, I'm not worthy. He's asking for mercy. So he not only name drops, he's basically begging, because of Abraham and Isaac, don't kill me. Do you see the perception Jacob has towards God here? Number one, I don't know if he's a good God. I don't know if he really wants to bless me. And I don't know if he wants to crush me. Do you know how offensive this is to God? To indirectly assume that he is maybe not good? Not a good idea. But God doesn't crush him, does he? Because that's not his character. This is the other side of this story. We're seeing God's character very clear here of who he is as God. And there's a lot of stories in the Bible, and it's important to understand the stories in the Bible and what their intent are. Like the book of Job, it's amazing to you how many people talk about the book of Job and go, well, I'm just like Job, my life is horrible, and now I have my Job experience. And it's like, the book of Job was never intended to teach us about how to live. The book of Job was to do two things, and this is a rabbit trail now, is to show us that the devil hates us and wants to crush us, and that God will always bring good out of wickedness. That's his intent. That's the whole point of the book of Job. That has nothing to do with what we're talking about. But we got to understand when it comes to the scriptures, we got to understand what is the point of the story here so we don't get mixed up and we try to pull something out of it that was never intended. There's all kinds of other places that do a much better job clarifying things. But in this story, it's talking about how we perceive God and how God perceives us in truth. So he begs for mercy. His family is split up. He's a mess. He's afraid of his brother. And then he reminds him about, hey, you're supposed to make my descendants great. Remember that promise you made? Who did God tell that he was going to make their descendants great? Abraham and Isaac. Jacob wasn't part of that conversation, but he's kind of liking the idea right now. He's thinking, can I have that idea too? And the point is, it is for you, but you have to receive it. You have to embrace it, and then you have to walk it out. And this is the challenge, and this is what Jacob is walking through here as he's trying to figure out, does God love me? Does God want to bless me? Who is God? How does this work? I've heard the stories for other people, but what about me? We can all have the same problem in our life. We can get into a situation in life where we can think something bad is going on, things aren't working out very good, and we can start to say, well, I know if God works for this person or for that person or for my parents or for my friends or for my whatever, but does he really want to do that for me? And God wants to answer that question this morning, I believe. So number two on your outline is God desires to bless you. That is his nature. That is his character. God is love. And he wants us to understand this. So as we follow this story, it magnifies further here what's going on in relation to Jacob and God and how God is going to break into this. It's kind of funny because as we look at verse 24, we'll just read this and then we'll come back and break it down here. This is so trippy. He's going to have this wrestling match with God. And that's why I love the Bible. It's so science fiction, but yet it's true. It says in verse 24, then Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until the breaking of day. Now when he saw that he did not prevail against him, he touched the socket of his hip, and the socket of Jacob's hip was out of the joint, and as he wrestled with him, and he said, let me go, for the day breaks. But he said, I will not let you go unless you bless me. So he said to him, what is your name? He said, Jacob. And he said, you shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have struggled with God and with men and have prevailed. Then Jacob asked, saying, tell me your name, I pray. And he said, why is it that you ask about my name? And he blessed him there. So Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, for I have seen God face to face and my life is reserved. Just as he crossed over Peniel, the sun rose on him and he limped on his hip. And so we got this story. We got to break down here. Number one, we know the man is in this story is God, probably Jesus, because in Genesis 35, it tells us. And we don't know exactly why, but why did this man come on the scene? It's a response to his prayer. He comes on the scene. Did this man come in his WWF outfit ready to wrestle? We don't know. I mean, he didn't come in and say, ding, ding, let's go. I mean, we don't know what happened. But obviously, a wrestling match took place. And this is how I think about it, is I love to wrestle with my kids. It's fun. Not right now, but it typically is fun. But there's times where I'll come around the corner into a room, and I didn't know it was wrestling match time. But it is. And that's fun, to a point. And I think this is what happens here. God shows up on the scene, wants to kind of work something out with Jacob, and Jacob wants to wrestle. He's 97. It's like, what is up with Jacob? Well, God is showing him something, and Jacob is learning about himself. So this wrestling match takes off. It goes on, and I think we could all say, if we were to peel back everybody's story in this room, we have all had wrestling matches with God, whether you know it or not. We all have had wrestling matches with God, and if you respond properly, life is much more productive than rebelling and running away from what he has. There's other stories that talk about that. But Jacob responds well. And what happens is they're wrestling. He doesn't want to let go. And he says, I won't let you go unless you bless me. See the perception here that Jacob had towards God? I got to do something. I got to wrestle. And then you'll bless me. Because the character of God is hinged upon us. No. God's character is God's character. He is a loving, blessing God, period. And he wants to make that clear in this story to Jacob as this unfolds. And he says, what is your name? Why did he say, what is your name to Jacob? You guys know what Jacob's name means? We talked about it, usurper. He's reminding him of this dysfunctional dude. He's like, hey, I want you to say your name so you remember who you are. Mr. Mature, do it all yourself, do everything in your own strength, you're smart, you don't need anybody's help. There goes your hip. And how dare you accuse me of not being a good blessing God? Don't you dare. You've heard the stories of Isaac. You've heard the story from Isaac and from Abraham. You know who I am. So don't you come in here with that. I should crush you. But that's not his character, is it? His character is love and patience and goodness, love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, kindness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. That's our God. He's revealing his character to Jacob, who thinks he doesn't need his help. And he says, what's your name? He reminds him of this, takes his hip out, and then he says, you have struggled with God and with men and have prevailed. In other words, I didn't kill you. Sometimes when I'm wrestling with my kids, I think they want me to like win to the nth degree. Because no matter what I do, they don't want to quit. And so I have to just finally be like, we're done! And they'll drag my, hold my leg to the next room. And this is what's happening here. Is God, he has prevailed with a poor attitude towards and perception of God, and God is correcting it. And this whole story of Jacob, as Jacob has struggled with his dad, his mom, his brother, his wife, his father-in-law, himself, all of those external issues and battles were not the problem. The whole problem was with his perception and intimacy with God. That was what was wrecking and keeping him from where God wanted to take him and where God's, what God's plan was. And for this, in order for his lineage to be like sands of the seashore, this had to be corrected. We can all fall into that same trap of perceiving God this way, that he wants to bless others and have a plan for other people's lives, but what about me? And we can think that maybe he doesn't want to, and he wants to correct that, and this story is glaringly showing us that. So then Jacob says, and this is really interesting, Jacob says to God, tell me your name. And God doesn't respond to him. He says, what is it? Why is it that you ask my name? Why does he ask? And why does God ask him, why do you want to know my name? You know my name, and he just blew him off. This is why. It's very interesting note of why this is a big deal. In pagan, at this time, this is happening between the Dead Sea and the Dead Sea and the Sea of Galilee. This is where it's taking place, kind of midway point in that area. But this is an interesting side note. The pagans believed that knowing the name of a god imparted ability to invoke that deity's power. That was permeated in the culture of his day. So, however, whoever knew the divine name and spoke it could wield that god's power. So here, however, the divine name is withheld, but later revealed, showing that the Lord's revelation of his name is gracious act of divine initiative, not a response to human effort to invoke control of God. So what is he saying? Just because I'm going to do these incredible things in your life, it's not because of you. Yes, we all have a part to play here, but just because you can say my name doesn't mean it's an automatic. In our day and age, oftentimes we use the name Jesus in our prayers, which is awesome. There's incredible power in the name of Jesus, but that doesn't release us from our responsibility to walk this life according to his plan for us. We can't, just because I said the name Jesus, everything's going to magically work out. We still have to obey and follow through on what he's calling and leading us to do. And this is why he changed his name from Jacob to Israel, because Israel means I have fought with God, or I have been with God, and God is with me, and I'm a soldier of God, and from this day forward, I'm going to be changed, and I'm going to go forward with God, not alongside God as him, somebody hanging in the background there, but I'm going to engage him in my life, and I'm going to let him lead the way here. I'm going to follow his lead. So Jacob changed from Jacob to Israel because of this experience he had, and when this experience happens, you know, this is what happens. Our life then becomes a mission. It gets laser focused, and anything that tries to stop us becomes an obstacle for you and God to conquer. This is what Jacob became when he became Israel. Life becomes an adventure, watching God make a way where there is none. Watching God make a way where there is none. Every challenge becomes a point of prayer, and every victory a point of praise. This is who God is. This is his character. This is what he wants to do. He wants us to understand that with him, we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. But we do need to take the step and engage him and invite him. There's an old saying, God is more concerned about our direction than our perfection. I can have all my morals right, and I can have all my theology right. I think the only one that's got their theology 100% right is the guy who went to the cross.
Pride will tell us that I've figured out everything in this book, and I know all the stories, and I know how to do everything. You're asking for it. That's a sign of immaturity. Immaturity says I'm mature. So if you want to be mature, you should say, I'm immature. I need God. I need Him involved in my life. When I wake up, when I go to sleep, when I walk throughout this day, I need His presence, His manifest presence in my life. I can't do this on my own strength. You can, but you'll look goofy with your hip out, hopping along there. And the beautiful thing about his hip going out is it was a reminder from God that He is dependent on Him going forward. So why did God do all this in Jacob's life? To correct his perception of who God is, of who he himself is, to be able to walk forward, to say, you know what, God wants to bless me, but why does God want to bless me? To bless others. Give and you shall receive. Give and it shall be given is a better way to say it. Give and it shall be given. 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 The whole point is for me to give is so that God can enlarge my capacity to be able to give more. To give, give, give. On this side of heaven, it's all about giving. Think about the cross. God gave huge. Didn't spare anything for us. So what should we spare? If you don't understand who God is, you don't understand if your perception towards Him isn't right, and we think about this giving process, it's going to be give so that I can get, so I can hoard, so I can have more. And that's true, but so that we can give, so that we can give, so we can be a channel of that. And so what I want to do here, we're not going to get through the rest of your outline this morning because we have, and we'll pick it up next week. I have a friend I want to invite up that has an incredible story about an event that took place in their life that has totally changed their family, and they're on a new course. So if everybody would welcome up with me Natalie Maxwell. Hi, Natalie.
Hi.
She did a great job at the first service, and so we want to take this time and just have her share her story with us.
Okay. Well, I'm Natalie Maxwell. More of you probably know my husband, Ryan. He plays guitar sometimes and helps with the youth group. But we've only lived in Bismarck about a year and a half now. Ryan got a job right out of school, and he moved here in April 2011, and we got married in June 2011. Our first couple months as newlyweds were pretty typical. We were both working a lot and just enjoying our new life together. We were going through Dave Ramsey's Financial Peace University class, and I will never forget one night, we were supposed to go home and write out like a two-year plan, and I was all for it. I was like, yes, I love lists. Let's just like get it out and we'll just like cross everything off as we go, right? And so we wrote about how we're both gonna work really hard and get out of debt. I'm gonna finish school, then I'm gonna get a really good job, then Ryan's gonna go back to school, and we're just gonna get all of that out of the way, and then after 2 years, then we'd think about starting a family. And God, because he's so funny, 2 days later, we found out that I was pregnant. And I remember...
Wrench into the plans.
Yeah, I remember bawling my eyes out and telling Ryan, this is going to change everything. This is going to ruin our plan. And it totally did. And in December, we had our first ultrasound, and we were overjoyed to find out that we were having a boy. We both really wanted our firstborn to be a son. And everything looked really great. The baby was a good weight. The doctor was happy. But she said she just had some concerns with how the blood looked like it was flowing through his heart, and the ultrasound couldn't get good pictures. So she said, just to be safe, I'm going to schedule you for a fetal echo the next day. I had no idea what a fetal echo was. And I thought, oh, like, it's nothing. Everything's great, and all of our dreams are coming true. This is awesome. And the next day, I went in for the fetal echo. Ryan didn't come with me because we both thought this is nothing, and he took off work the day before, so I went by myself, and it was pretty much just an ultrasound, but they can get better pictures of the baby's organs. So I watched for 2 hours as my little baby did flips and was all over the place, gave the nurse a run for her money, and I was like, there can't possibly be anything wrong with this child. And then the cardiologist came in after, like, 2 hours. And after a while, I started thinking, there might actually be something wrong. I heard the words closed and no flow and a bunch of other long medical terms that I had no idea what they meant. And after a while of him looking, he had me sit up in bed, and by this time I'm holding back tears, and he brought over his chair, and he had some paper, and he drew a picture of a heart, and he said, this is what a normal heart looks like, and now I'm going to draw your son's heart. And right there and there, like, my heart just stopped, and he went on to tell me that our son, Landon, we already knew that that was his name, has pulmonary atresia and intact ventricular septum. It's a really long word. And because of that, his right ventricle wasn't developing. And he said, right now, he's fine in you. He's getting everything he needs from the placenta. But once he's born, blood won't be able to get to his lungs. So he said that I'll have to be transferred to University of Minnesota to be treated there. And once Landon's born, he'll be kept alive on medicine until he can have his first open heart surgery. And then he'll probably have to have multiple ones before he turns 3. So after that, our life changed dramatically. Our plans were completely thrown out the window. We didn't know what life was gonna look like. We didn't know, we knew that we had this baby, but we knew that once he was born, we had no guarantees. And that was terrifying. And I did a lot of wrestling with God. And our lives were full of doctor's appointments and researching and just everything. And then the last month of my pregnancy, I had to move to Minneapolis. And I was blessed to have an aunt that lives right outside the city. So I lived in her basement for a month, which was one of the hardest times for me because I'm pregnant and have a ton of different emotions just from that. But then I had nothing to distract me from this fear that I had. And I will never forget one morning doing my Bible study. It was the Beth Moore Bible study. And reading these words. The most critical breakthrough of faith you and I could ever experience is to let God bring us to a place where we trust him, period. We don't trust him to let us avoid what we fear most. We determine to trust him no matter what, even if our worst nightmare befalls us. We have no greater victory and can render Satan no harsher blow. That struck such a chord in me. I realized that I had a choice to make. Was I going to trust God only if he answered my prayers? Could I still love and follow a God who takes my baby from me? Beth Moore challenged me to write out 3 if and thens. If blank happens, then blank. I wrote with hands shaking and tears getting in the way of my clear vision. If Landon is taken from us, then God has a purpose for his life that surpasses his time on earth. I sobbed as I penned these words in my journal. Lord, I don't want to only trust you that our fears about Landon won't come true. I want to trust that even if they do, you are still good. Even if they do, you are still faithful. Even if they do, you are still love. And even if they do, you are still our God and we will still follow you. And less than a week later, Landon was born.
Okay, so we have a video to show you that kind of follows that process. So let's go and play that.
All we have to hold on to is what we know is true of who you are. So we're not
pretty incredible little story there. What a little trooper. So where does that put you guys now then? How's Landon doing now, and what's the future like?
Landon is doing amazing right now. He continues to just amaze his cardiologist. His heart has actually grown quite a bit, which they were never expecting, and that's prayer. He was supposed to go back to Minneapolis next month for another heart cath and maybe another open heart surgery. But they just called me back a couple days ago and told me that he's doing so good, he may not need a surgery for another year, awesome. Which is such a miracle. And as far as our family, we've been forever changed. We no longer make two-year plans. We live for each day, and we cherish every moment. Landon has really taught us that life is so short, and that we can't live our lives for the here and now, and to just, we don't want our life to be focused anymore on how much we can do, on how much we can accomplish, but really how many lives we can touch with the love of Christ in this short amount of time that we have. And that's changed our entire family. God is leading us in directions that are very scary.
So tell us a little bit about the Pillow Pets and what you're going to do coming up here.
Yes. The Pillow Pet Project was birthed in me and Ryan's heart just because of God won't let us forget, and we don't want to. Our eyes have been open now to pain and suffering, and the kids' faces that we met while we were in the hospital are forever burned into our hearts. And the other, a couple months ago, I was praying and I was asking God, you know, what can we do next time we go back to the hospital to reach out beyond Landon's room and really encourage the families and bring some hope into this place. And God gave us the Pillow Pet idea, and we decided that we would try to raise money to purchase Pillow Pets to bring back and give to these kids when we go back. I thought maybe, you know, we'll raise a couple $100s, and Ryan was like, well, let's try to buy 100, which is $2,000, and I was like, okay, I'll put it out there that that's our goal, but I really didn't think we'd get anywhere close to that, and as of yesterday, we're at 1,600. So God has just taken that and just blown our minds, and he's opened so many doors in the hospital. I talked with the children's administrator at Amplatz the other day, and usually they don't let people, they just accept donations, and they don't let people actually give out the Pillow Pets or whatever people are giving. But she heard our story, and she thought the idea was awesome. Her kids have Pillow Pets, and she's like, that's just the best thing that these kids could have in their room. And so she's going to personally escort us around, and we're going to get to meet these kids and hopefully pray with the parents and be an encouragement. And we were going to do that while Landon was in the hospital, but now he's not having to go back. So God has just worked it out that we were, my aunt is having Thanksgiving, so we will go down the day before Thanksgiving, buy a lot of Pillow Pets because they're already taking over our apartment, and I don't know how we'll carry them all down there. So we'll buy Pillow Pets, and then on Thanksgiving Day, we will spend the whole day at Amplatz Children's Hospital, meeting the kids and bringing a smile to their faces and maybe giving them a little something to be thankful for and telling them that God loves them and that he hasn't forgotten about them. And we're so excited, and if we have more Pillow Pets left over, then we will hit up the Ronald McDonald House the next day and play with the kids there. And we just want to make a difference. After a really scary experience in the hospital one day, I wrote on my blog that we don't want a normal life anymore, that we want to be a family that's familiar with suffering and that comforts others with the comfort we've received. And God has just taken that prayer and held us to it, and he is calling us to do some really scary things. We know that he's calling us to adopt kids with special needs, that's the path we're headed down. And we don't know what that looks like, but we know that we serve an amazing God. And we may not be able to give kids very much, but we can give them love. Mm-hmm. And if that means, you know, traveling across the world to find these kids that have been abandoned and rejected by their society, then we will go. And we've just laid it all out there and completely surrendered to God and whatever He has for us. And yeah.
That's pretty awesome, huh? Woo! Yeah. Before you go, we just want to close here in prayer. If you guys just stretch your hands out towards Natalie, and we'll just pray for her and the family. And God, we come to you and thank you that nothing is too big or too small for you, and that we can bring all of our concerns, our cares, and you are there and you are listening and you are able and willing. And so God, we just lay hands on her and we stretch our hands towards her and her family. Yeah, an expression of faith. God, we pray for, first of all, for Landon, that you will just keep him growing healthy and strong, God, that his heart will do amazing things that will surprise the doctors, God. We just pray. Just heal him, Lord. And thank you for the testimony he's been already and for what he's going to be in his life, in his generation. It's going to pass the torch on to the next generation. And Lord, for Natalie and Ryan, just for strength for them when they lay down to go to sleep, even if it's for a short time, just for supernatural rest. We just pray for continued divine opportunity in their life, favor on their lives. We know you've got a plan, but we know it's our job to pray, so we do. And we all agree together with this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's give her a round of applause for coming up. Thanks, Natalie. So just like our story with Jacob, Natalie and Ryan had a life-transforming experience. And God wants us to understand He's good. And one of the things that you didn't get to say at this service, she said at the first service, is no matter what happens, we still have heaven. So even if we don't get to have the big house and the big 10 cars and the whatever, and nothing against that, if you have that, but we still have heaven. The point is to obey God and to follow His lead. He's a good God. He's got a plan. He can turn things around for good as we let Him, no matter what happens in our life, He's a good God. And when we get to heaven someday, we're going to understand that fully. But in the meantime, He wants us to be a vessel of His goodness in and through us. God, we thank you for again this morning and for your goodness and your faithfulness. And Lord, for everything that's going on around us with the election and with rumors of war and economic issues and social issues. God, we just thank you that nothing is too big for you. We submit it all to you. We pray for this election coming up, God, that your will would be done. And Lord, whoever's in office, that all of our people that are serving in politics, God, would hear your voice. They would have their own Jacob experience, have dreams and visions, and that they would help us to get back on track as a country to serve you and to stay on track and to allow you to be God. And Lord, we just need you because we don't even know what that means sometimes. How to do that, how to navigate those things can be really difficult. So, but we know you can do it. So we just cry out to you and ask for your help, Lord, as we move forward, as we leave this place. We pray that you will guide us, direct us, fill us with your Spirit to overflowing. We trust you with it all, and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand, and we'll close with the Lord's Prayer. If you're here this morning and want more information about this Jesus who wants to be so intimate with each and every one of us, He wants to be personally in our life, and if you're here this morning and say, I don't know how to do that, we have a packet for you, a Bible for you, with some information and a gift for you. If you're a guest here this morning or like more information, we have a packet and a gift for you as well. Let's close with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. God bless you guys. Oh, wait, I have one quick announcement. Mike's going to make an announcement here.
Yes.
questions.
Yes. We are actually setting up for Trunk or Treat right now in this room. So what we would love for you guys to do is pick up, help us pick up the seats and move them over to that wall and stack them up over on that wall. So whatever seat you're sitting in, please pick that one up. And just we just want to move them all along that wall right over there. So
if you're physically able to help.
If you're physically able to help. And they go right up against that wall over there by Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Thank you. Yep, we just want to stack up the chairs right over there and get them stacked up so we can get a lot over there. Hello? Oh, no, not over on that wall. We want them all over on this wall. Thank you. Thanks.